I'm curious about the sort of the day-to-day voter in these countries that did go you know, towards the far right, that was appealing, where it was appealing to them. How are they feeling today? Do you have conversations with people who ascribe to that ideology but also are resigned to the fact that it's not, they're not in power?
Yeah, well, we have kind of detailed surveys about the voters. So, for example, in the French case, what is really interesting is that, I mean, interesting and of course worrying, is that it's about a large part of the former working class voting for the communists or the left is now has now shifted to the far right. So it's usually kind of blue collar.
Generational.
Yeah, it's generational. It's also very marked sociologically, so it's kind of depressed cities or suburbs in difficulties. It's working blue-collar class who cannot find any kind of, you know, secured job and feeling well integrated. So sociologically, it can be identified. It's so they are really cluster of people voting for the far right, and some of them are fine with just being on the protest side and don't really hope that things could change really at the political level, so they just express their disillusion with the political system. And of course, very often, if they don't have the choice to vote for far right, they wouldn't vote at all. So it's really people retracting from politics globally. And some really hope that if far right was in power, things would change. But I think many of them are also realistic that not so many things can be changed.
What does someone like President Macron do? Because he can't ignore them. What's the middle ground for a president like Macron?
Well, I think something important he has been saying explicitly is that the problem is the far right as political party, but not their voters. Their voters are normal and legitimate citizens, and their claim should be heard. So I think that's a positive element, you know, not to try to marginalize them and to recognize that they have expressed democratic, through their democratic votes, they have expressed something that is important. Then, of course, addressing both the immigration and the job market issue are quite challenging, because the point is, if you want to deconstruct the narrative, you need to be able to work at the big structural level. And that's much more complicated, of course, to kind of recreate the feeling that this part of the population is integrated.
How does he bring them to the discussion table? I mean, is it seen as something that's politically incorrect to do, to have an open discussion with members of the far right?
No, I think now the far right has become so powerful and obvious in the political landscape, at least for the French one, that it's now fine to consider that it's important for politicians to speak to the voters of Marine Le Pen. And one of the things Macron, I think, has been trying to do is to bring at the European level the discussion about, you know, multilateralism, globalization, protectionism, how are we sure that we keep job in Europe? How do we try to solve the tensions between new members and old members of the European Union in terms of, you know, job, employment, and so on? So he's addressing some of these issues, but of course, it takes time to change. And then you need other countries to also try to push in the same direction.
And Europe, come on board, sure.
Yeah, and Europe even in such difficulties with the Brexit, with Catalonia now, that unfortunately it's also difficult to try to get consensus on this kind of job-related and protectionism issues.